Perfect. Okay. So many of them are sitting. Sure.
Right. Good morning, everyone. I have opened the Champion of the Week form, so do well to go in there and nominate whoever you think deserves it for the week, and don't forget to add the reason. So by the end of the lecture, we would announce the winner for this week. All right. Have a great day.
Thank you, Derek. Let's get started, guys. I hope everybody is sleeping on. So, guys, wake up first of all. Now let's start studying. This is a day for learning. Your instructor Lloyd, he is having a surgery. So let's first pray for him, like that he have a successful surgery and he can join you guys like in next couple of days on Tuesday, hopefully with the good health. So secondly, I will be covering for him for today on for Sunday and Monday. So for 3 days, you have to bear me. You have to listen to me. Sorry about that. So then Lloyd will be there. Guys, first of all, wake up. Everyone have the breakfast. I hope like you should have like tea or egg and everything. So with the full stomach, it's always good to study. It's like for me at least, like I normally eat something before doing the classes, before the lectures. So today, guys, I hope everybody's wake up. So today is our last day. First of all, tomorrow is a weekend, so that's a happy Thursday. And tomorrow you can sleep and you can just go outing somewhere. So before starting, you guys have must have seen me in, like on Sunday mostly. So I will just a quick, like today is officially I will be teaching the whole day for the first half to you. So my name is guys Muhammad Uzair Siddiqui and I am the associate instructor in Coding Dojo. I have been in this IT world for around 15 years. And that's a long time. I started as an administrator, and after that, like you know, they're checking up the group policies, active directories, DNS servers, making the servers exchange, and working day-to-day tasks. Then I moved towards network and started to work on switches, routers, firewalls a bit, and RJ45, checking the UTP cables if they are working fine or not. And at that time, there was not allowed of the like they there was not a, like a lot of cloud was not there, but still like the normal network I used to see. So I have done my first CCNA in 2011 at that time. So since then, I'll be renewing all the Cisco certifications. So I've joined Cisco Systems after that, and I was working as a consultant for them as a subject matter expert for few of the Cisco appliances. Like you can search on the Google Cisco ESA, email gateways, web securities, proxy appliances, next generation firewalls. ESA is one of the best firewalls of Cisco. So I was working for different series of firewall, 55, 15, 25. So that was specifically cybersecurity. Cybersecurity, guys, it's not only about Linux or Kali, it's about network as well. Like if you are putting something up in the cloud, so you required some brokers in between them such that they are there, and if there is any issue or there is any breach of security, so those brokers are working and they are fighting against them, those threats. So there's a lot over there in the market. If we talk about cybersecurity, there is a lot. And it's not like if we talk about the scenarios over here, like what we are doing in the boot camp. In the real market, when you go as a work, like go in a market and start doing the job, so there will be like quite a difference, and you will learn a lot. The good thing is that learning. So whenever you are in the IT world, the biggest I can say problem nowadays that you need to learn. You need to learn day to day. You need to evolve. So anyways, so I have done certifications. I've been teaching and I've been training a lot for last couple, like last 3 years, not only to the students, but to the corporate level, like there are the products of different Palo Alto, Cisco products and different QRadars, IBM QRadars, if you've heard about. So I basically go and give the POC. There's something known as POC. These are the guys, first of all, everyone, how many students like I do have in this session? I'm not sure, like there are 20, 25, like whatever the number is. So guys, first of all, open your pads, open the 20. Thank you, Abdullah. Abdullah, you're the same guy like who was working for F5, I believe. Yeah. There was, I remember. Yeah, okay, I remember you. So there was Ibrahim as well. Like they were like quite interactive in the session. Guys, everyone, please respond me on chat such that I can keep my energy running. Like if you're slow, I will become slow. If you are good, I will be good. So please, like, you know, the chat is very important. If you don't want to speak, go to the chat. Speaking is good. So anyways, open your notepad, guys, and start writing down. Like, this is not basically your bootcamp. This is not the security plus. Like, few of the words that I will be using, like, put it in the notepad and you can search it afterwards. There's something known as, in our IT world, that is known as POC. POC is basically proof of concept. This is one of the important thing when you're deploying any of the hardwares, or if you're deploying any of the boxes or machines in any production environment. So you must develop a POC. It's not like that you will just buy an appliance, buy an ASA directly, put over there, start working. No, that's not the thing how it works. You need to make sure that your concept, like if there is an environment, for example, this is LAN, a LAN environment, and you are working on DMZ, there are the gateways. You want to deploy one more gateway. I normally work with FireEye. You can search FireEye as well, guys. FireEye is a very good cybersecurity teams, and that's a very good organization. So if you also have an email gateway and you want to implement FireEye for the outgoing emails, so you need to create a POC first. POC is the proof of concept. Proof, you need to prove that what you are doing is correct, and your concept, like whatever your concept is, that okay, I will, the placement of my FireEye would be between the proxy and the firewall, or that will be between after the DMZ when we are entering in an internal network, then I will put the FireEye. You need to prove that. So normally when we go to some corporates, to the banking environment, 90% where I work, so we just check that how the compatibilities are, like whether we can install this appliance or not. Like there is something very important, rollback. You must have a rollback plan. If something goes wrong, roll back, go back to the normal state. But that's like that there's big ego problem when you do this. So it's not a good practice, but you need to be sure about your concept. So that was just note down each and everything, like apart from this bootcamp, apart from these lectures, I will be coming up with some new terms. So guys, I've been training a lot for like 3 years for the corporate training, and I have done different certifications like Amazon. I've been working, and I like migration in Amazon is very important. Like you are migrating your whole database up in the cloud. So I was doing that like in 2 years back, and I just did a certificate, but now I'm totally towards these days towards CompTIA. CCNA, the latest one. I know, like if you want to ask some questions about Cisco, like how the simulations work, how the switches work, how the routers work, so I can guide you with that. I normally train students for that. Basically, I train corporate a lot, like more of that, like those are the people who are already working. So they that's a different scenario. But apart from that, I have done CompTIA Network Plus, Security Plus, ITIL. ITIL is the foundation course that you basically implement. Those are the library of different framework, like whenever you are implementing any application. So you should know like how the services work, how the helpdesk work, and what are what are problem management, what is incident management, and how the incidents work, and what are the service management. Like, well, normally we talk about service management a lot, so you need to make sure Linux, NSC, this, that's the FortiGate. I have done different certification for Palo Alto as well, for autopsy, that's the forensics, like a lot now. So I'll be preparing myself for PMP. It's tough. So by the end of the year, I'm not sure, like I don't have time anymore now these days, but let's see. I have been working for Cisco Security Plugs. I told you, email gateway, web security, M endpoint, next generation firewalls are very important. So you you must be going through in the labs. I was working with the Cisco Wireless LAN Controls, WLC. If you guys have heard about WLC, these are the wireless LAN controller. And if you have the different access points, like if you want to connect your access points with WLC, you can. Cisco WebEx Jabber, there's something also known as SolarWind, SolarWind PRTG. If you guys, anyone knows about SNMP? SNMP. Anyone? Guys, wake up. Lecture today. Our lecture will be the normal lecture that we will be just moving ahead. And that is like more towards incident management. So that's like I will be going through the lecture. Adnan, don't have to worry. So anyone knows about SNMP, guys? Anyone? Mm-hmm. Okay, perfect. So SNMP, just for a quick reminder, guys, like SNMP is basically, yes, thank you, Abdullah. That's like a simple network management protocol. And what it does, it just check like how your network is working, how your bandwidth is working. So in a free time, guys, first of all, like lectures are like the lectures that we do every day in our bootcamp. That's like, again, theory. But if you really want to go in the market, yes, for the networking, that's for the monitoring purpose, totally agree with this. So if you really want to go in the market, like I'm talking about the real world where you will just go and find a job. So, and like there are different softwares, there are different tools. So that will be quite different as compared with the, you know, with the theory part, like what we normally do. So that's why I've asked you to open your notepads so you can write about SolarWind, you can write about PRTG. So when I will be going through the labs, like when I will visit you guys, so we can talk a little bit about the Palo Alto checkpoints and different things like normally we do. So now, coming to the chapter, that's what we will be discussing in today's lecture would be privacy and data sensitivity concepts, like what the privacy are and what the sensitivity of are, like how we can secure. The most important thing about any of the network is that you need to make sure that your data is secure. The what is the basic concept of any of the cybersecurity guys or any security engineer is that you make sure that you are protecting your data, whether your data is a private data, your secret data, classified data, there are different variants of data. So you need to make sure that data is being, is there, and it's very important that you protect your sensitive data, that there's no breach of security. So that's the real job of any of the IT guy. The second IT guy job is the security guy, is that if there is any disaster, so how you will recover, like that's like done, there was a disaster, how you will recover it. In next chapters, we will study this a bit. So today's our primary topic would be the privacy and the data sensitivity and how you can save and how you can protect the data using the data protection controls. So privacy and sensitive data concepts. So what is privacy and versus security? So obviously privacy is something that you have a sensitive data. Like normally we have our personal PII data. PII is our personal information data. That's like, for example, you are hired for an organization, like the HR department will come to you and they will say that, hey, Abdullah, can you provide us your contact details? Can you provide us your contact numbers? Can you provide your email ID? Can you provide us your address? Can you provide us your phone numbers and everything. Like, that's your totally personal data. They will ask you, the HR team. So that data is basically your personal data. Even your account details would be asked, because like, if they are not opening your account, so that that your existing account would be asked, that okay, your paychecks will be directly transferred to your accounts. So in that scenario, you need to make sure that this data, this PII, that's personal information, should be secure. So this is your privacy, like very important data. That's like highly like the next version. Like if you multiply privacy with like twice, so that's considered as sensitivity. Like that's like sensitive data. Then it's like if you have your account details and your credit card details or your debit card details are there, so that's like highly sensitive data. Then like that's privacy, is that your number, your email, or, and if you talk about sensitivity, like that's like more than privacy. So that's your highly sensitive data. So that could be your credit card details, your account numbers, your debit card details. Security. So obviously, like whenever there's a data, you need to make sure that the data is being secure, and you need to make a security. Like if the HR department, let's go back to the HR department. HR department will make a folder in their, for example, laptop or in their share folder. Normally we have a Microsoft SharePoint that would be there. So the folder will be there and everyone's data would be there. This folder, they will use, the permissions are not given to everyone. So this would be only accessible. That would be only accessible by the HR team or the CEO or a finance team, like maybe. So no other than like the sales guys, marketing guys, or IT guys, or any other guys, like they cannot access this folder. Even this folder would be like password protected, like username and the password is required just to maintain logs. Normally logs, like we maintain logs by this, like we just protect it. So this is like how we can secure our simple folder, and we can make sure that our folder is secure and nobody basically breach the security and get that useful data of Abdullah, for example. So like we need to make sure. Information lifecycle management. So whenever you create anything, like guys, like this is information lifecycle, or this is your own lifecycle of your life. Like as a baby, you are born, then you grow up, then you start learning, and then you start teaching. For example, you're going for a job and you are graduate, then you start a job, then you have a family, then finally you get retired in life, and then finally we die. So that's the circle of life. So same goes for our information life cycle. First, we create something, like we create a simple document. That document can be an Excel file that you're creating. That's the creation. Or you can say collection. You're collecting the data, like you are working for an organization XYZ, and that organization requires you to collect. That's the requirement of that. That's a sales type of a company, and they require lead generation. Lead generations, normally we do have in our organization lead generation. So you just want that data. So you collect that data using the social networking sites like Facebook. You just go to the WhatsApp, Instagram. You find like the data from your own network and you collect that data. Now you're creating an information. Your information is converted into data. Remember this. Like first thing you require the information. When you write something, that's converted into data. So you are finding the information and you're converting into data. You're collecting it, making a file. So that's collection. Now you forward this data to the software house guys or your production team or your in-house software team, that okay, now you can use this data and you can do whatever you want to do. Like you can ask the call center guys to give a call and to generate that lead into the opportunity. Like normally we convert our leads to opportunities. So you can convert that. So that's the distribution or the use of data. Now, this data was of 2019. Now, mostly you're done with this Excel file now. There were 200 entries in that. Now it's done. So now you will say that, okay, just retention time. That means like, okay, now you can dump this database. Normally we say this is a database DB, database. dump this database to our archival folders. Normally we archive it. Normally you archive it. You can buy a service from Amazon. Again, write it down, guys. For the archival purpose, there's a very good service in Amazon that we normally do. That is known as Amazon Glacier. That's very cheap. That's used for the archival purpose. So that's your retaining a data. Now, as per your company policies, guys, as per your company policy, you're working for xyz.com. Their policy is that you need to retain that data. You need the data should be there for at least 2 years, or at least 2 years, for example, 2 years retention. So you will keep this data in the Amazon Glacier, like that's the database. Like you will just put that database directly up there in the cloud for 2 years. After that, you will put a filter over there at after exactly 2 years, just delete it. That is also known as disposal. So you can dispose that data that's gone now. For that's like normally organizations are doing, because like there's so much data running all the time. So they just get the data, use the data, retain it for some time, then dispose it all. So that's known as disposal. There are different techniques for disposal in our real world. If you want, like there are, if you talk about hard drives, so you can just don't damage it. Like that could be, the data could be retrieved again. So there are high machines, high magnetic machines, like that is so known as sanitizations, like normally we do, or glossing, like yes, that there are the different words that we normally use for the disposal. For our hard drive, for the physical hard drive, we can dispose. But in our Amazon world or in our cloud world, we normally don't dispose like this. We normally just, what we do, we just directly, that's a, there is a policy that we do, that on today is whatever the day. For example, on October 5th, 2022, just dispose this data off, that's deleted. So that will be gone. Guys, everyone is, you know, everyone is, sorry to interrupt. Head emoji. Okay, guys, please just everyone in the classroom, I have instruction just to show like the thumbs up. Everyone, like everyone is alive in the classroom. So everyone thumbs up, please thumbs up. Everyone quick. Guys, wake up, I'm not talking to myself. Raise hand in the emoji, guys. Raise hand in the emoji. Okay, there's a new instruction, raise hand. I can raise hand, I'm not sure, sorry. Sorry about that, guys. No, in the what you call that, Zoom, you need to raise up your hand. Thanks, Avi, thanks. Yeah, thanks, Abdullah. You're my F5 guy. Like, I will be learning from you F5 someday. So I'm not good in load balancers. So guys, please raise the hand. Raise the hand. That's what, thank you, sir. Raise the hand in the, what you call it, in the Zoom. Raise hand is within the reaction section. Thank you, Derek. Raise hand in the reaction center. At the section. Yes. Finally. Then click on the tap on the reaction. Thank you. Guys, wake up. Please, everyone. Do whatever my boss said to me. Thank you, Derek. Whatever my boss said to me, do that. Thank you, everyone, please. So, Derek, you can just continue with that. So, guys, just do this attendance stuff just for the raise hands. Please do that. So, perfect. So guys, back to our topic then. So you will be doing this, do that, like whatever the reasons. So I like any question regarding guys regarding disposal or regarding any creation or anything, please do let me know. Any question? Anyone? Is it clear? Everyone, are you with me? Are you alive, everyone? Clear. Answer me, please. Yes. Just put why. That's it. I don't want you to burn your calories a lot. Just put why. Okay. Thank you. That's it. Yeah, thank you. Just put why in the chat. So I'm clear that, okay, everyone is with me. Therefore, why? Thank you. Thank you, guys. Okay. So Next is the debtor roles and responsibilities. So everyone in the organization is having their roles. So whenever you create a debtor, the same example that we were going through for the HR department, like the HR guys have just hired Abdullah in their organization, hopefully in F5, I pray. So he's there now. They have asked for his account details, for his debit card details, for his email address, for his address and for his whole name, his father name, everything. Like what are like, there's a form that you need to fill up, inshallah, you will definitely. So the form that you normally fill up and normally you work on that form. So that's your PII. Now the HR department has put that information in the folder we already talked about and that's shared. Now, while that folder is shared, there are different roles and responsibility there can be on this folder. Who has created this folder is considered as the data owner. He is the person that was someone, for example, in our HR department, I'm not sure like why there was a person, Todd, he called me. So he was a VP, he's a VP. So as for me, he's a data owner. Like he will just hire me. He's a responsible person. He's a top person. He's a senior executive. So he will maintain everything. Like he has every right. He have every permission. He can delete my data. He can even like he can sell my data as well. So he's the best person. So he's the owner, a senior executive, a role with the ultimate responsibility for maintaining the confidentiality, integrity, availability for the information asset. So he's a person who is doing the job, who's creating the data. Then we have another role, steward. Obviously the head of HR person will not every day, he will not come and check that folder. So a person would be hired, a steward or a custodian, who will check the data, like whether to label it or to ensure that the data is fine. So that is considered as a steward. This is a role, is primarily responsible for the data quality. That's all. This involves tasks such as ensuring data is labeled and identifies, like whether the data is to the correct person or not, like they have put the entry and that entry was for Abdullah or that entry was for Haya, like that there could be something. So make sure that it's fine. Custodian, this is a role handles managing the system on which the data assets are stored. This includes responsibility for enforcing the access list. Very important term, access list. I'm pretty much sure like Lloyd must have told you about all access list encryption and the backup recoveries. But still, if you have any question, guys, I will visit you in my lab timing. Today I will not be going in my other lab, that is the there's another cohort running, so I will not going there today. I will be with you going through in the labs. So if you have any question regarding ACS, you can ask me. What are the inbound ACLs, what are the outbound ACLs, what are the stateful, stateless firewalls, how they work, anomaly scans, how they work, and how you configure the ACL. Very simple. What are the permit, what is the deny, what is the implicit deny? So you can ask me, like not right now in the lab. If you have any question, you can just note it down. When I visit your rooms, you can ask me regarding encryption, symmetric, asymmetric, what type of the encryptions are there, what is RSA, what is two-fish, and what is AES. AES is very common. How do you use AES? What is block streaming? Like what is a block cipher? What is a stream cipher? What is bit by bit? And anyways, so if you have any question, you can ask me in the breakup rooms, not right now, so I can discuss this. So the custodian will help you with the backups and recovery measures. Privacy officer, this is a person, like this could be any audit guy. This is like considered as an audit guy, and they do the auditing, like the data is secure. So this role is responsible for oversight of any personal identifiable information asset managed by the company. So 90% this is given to the audit team, like they just check and they even audit. Like even over here, they audit, and in the processors also they audit. So controller is an entity responsible for determining why and how the data is stored, collected, used, and for ensuring that these purposes and are means for the lawful. So like obviously, like lawful means, the term lawful is important. That means like you are, your, like we do have inside threat in our organization, guys. Like we do have inside threat. So obviously you need to make sure you're auditing and you're checking like whether it's like under the control or not, it's like the data is not breached. So that's very bad. Processors, any entity engaged by the data controller to assist with the technical collection, storage or analysis tasks. So like more or less, like we normally use two or three roles, like the owner is there, custodian is there, and the controllers. Like the controller can be doing the job of the privacy officers and the processors. So like we don't hire people for this. So that's just the role and the responsibility. Now we can classify the data. Classification of the data is more important. Like if you guys have used SQL, or if you guys are familiar with the database, so we can classify the data in our Amazon very easily. Like we just classify the data. So you can classify by the data by using the color labels, like labeling that, okay, this is the Excel file. Let's just talk about the Excel or spreadsheet. So this is an Excel file. This is like classified with green color. So that means that's public. Everyone. Public means like you can see them in the social media. For example, our company, again, xyz.com. This is our company. You can directly visit our company by going to their websites, and the data in the website is public. Like everyone can see about us, everyone can contact to us, everybody can see our products, our solutions, our consultations. Like normally, like we are a consultant company, for example, guys, so that's open for everyone. That's unclassified. Now let's talk about a bit about confidential data. So that's secret. Now I will not share my customer information, my private customer information numbers, for example, Dell is my customer. I will not provide the POC. There's something, again, right, guys, in your notepad, POC is also considered as proof of concept, and it is also considered as point of contact. Write it down in your notepad, point of contact. Remember this. This is a point of contact. So I will never put my point of contact in my website. That Adnan was the guy, he is a sales manager of Dell. So I will not give my Adnan's information on the website. That okay, you can contact them. So that's confidential, that's secret for me. Then there is critical and top secret. Now, I will never put the information of Adnan. Sorry, Adnan, I'm using your name. I just saw the chat window in the participants, Adnan's name. So I've just took your name, Adnan Ayan. So sorry. So Adnan is our sales guy. So I will not give his number. But over here, critical is like how much Adnan is paying me. Let's talk about dollars now or real. How much Adnan is paying me? Like how much Adnan pays me for the services. That's even more important. That's top secret now. That how much we charge Adnan for the consultation, that is top secret. So public, that's like unclassified, secret. We do have confidential data as well, guys. That's also known as a secret. So we can also divide secret and confidential as well. But more or less, like there are three categories: public, confidential, critical. So that's like how it works in our work. So there is one more data classification, proprietary. Like if you guys must have gone through the iOS, or we have talked about Apple, for example, in Apple App Store, everything is proprietary, and Mac OS is basically running on Apple only. So that's their proprietary. You cannot run Mac OS on some other processors, for example, on any other motherboard or any CPU. You know, it's impossible. Like that's not allowed, basically. So you will be just running Apple, or and the Mac OS will always be running on Apple computers or MacBooks. So that's proprietary. Apple will say that's my thing. That's my. So that's proprietary. We have private and personal. So we only talked about PII. So that's private. That's my private and personal information, my contact details, my name, my father name, my email address. And sensitive is our credit card details or account number. This label is usually used for the context of a personal data that is more personal, like your credit card or your account details or your spouse name or your children name. So that's like quite personal. So that is known as sensitive data. Now, data types are personally identifiable information, PII. We have different, if you guys have heard about, like in the next slide, we do have DLP. DLP is very important, data loss prevention in our data life. If you talk about the real world, if you go in a job. So the most important thing is that you must know about the DLP policies. If you are really becoming a cybersecurity guy and you are a person who is responsible of the data, that your data is secure, that the job of the security guys. So you must be clear about DLP. And I will explain you DLP. Like again, if you have confusion, I will go through in the labs. So I will explain you more. So there are different type of data. PII is our, again, the same thing I have just gone through. Your name, your personal name, your spouse name, your father name, your address, your contact details, customer data, customer information, customer company, point of contact, customers, like how much customer pay you. So that could be customer data that comes in. There's something known as PHI. That's your personal health information. Normally PHI is, there's a policy. Write it down, guys, again, HIPAA. HIPAA is one of the policies that you can just use for the health information. Like there are medical, there are hospital after this COVID-19. So the health policies are getting improved and they are focused. They're a lot in focus. Like the personal data, for example, there's a person, XYZ or ABC. That ABC is having a heart disease and that guy is, God forbid, that he is in cancer and he have a time limit for 2 months. So that's very, very personal. That's very, very personal. So that's the data that you should make sure that's secured. So that is considered as the PHI, that's personal health information. And the policy that we normally make, that is known as HIPAA, that is normally we use. There's finance data. Normally we say that is a PCI, and that's a payment card industry, DSS. That's a policy that we create, and that's our financial information. Like 90% financial information are in the banking environment. Like you use financial information banks like Standard Chartered Bank or Riyadh Bank, for example, or Saudi Bank. So they are the bank, and bank have their credit card details, debit card details, account details. So that information is very, very, very sensitive. So normally we create a policy for that. That's known as PCI or DSS. Government data can be your SSN number, social security numbers, your passport details, your ID details, and that's like your birth details. So whatever the data is shared with the governments, so that is considered as a governmental data. So we normally create a policy for that, like how this data could be secure. So that is known as DLP. I will talk about DLP in a minute. So guys, any question, guys, everyone there? Guys, just put why. You're not there. No, please. No, don't do this. Don't do this. You know, okay, why? That was funny. That was really funny. Okay, thank you. Yes, please just put why. Thank you, guys. So please be alive and listen to me. I'm sorry, I talk too much, but that will be helpful for you, inshallah, for your future career, for your future endeavor. So, let's go for the privacy notice and data retention. Only talked about data retention, like how you retain the data, but privacy notice, what they are, like normally you see the notice boards in your universities that, okay, you need to do this. Those are the notice boards in our IT world. Those are privacy notice, that how you collect the data, what is the purpose of the data, and where you store the data. So that is the privacy notice, like, okay, this data, that, for example, there is a SOP, There's an SOP for xyz.com. That's our consultant company, that nobody is allowed to talk. The SOP of the company is that you should not use a bad language. So if somebody does, so they will take a privacy notice, like the gender discrimination should not be there. So everything comes in the SOP, and you put a privacy notice in your company, and you need to follow that. So informed consent means that the data must be collected and processed only for the stated purpose. So whatever the HR department is collecting the data, that should be only for specific purpose. Like that is for the payroll purpose. Like we have talked about the HR department. HR department took our data. That is only for the payroll purpose, for our contact details. That's it. They cannot share that data to anyone else. That's the privacy notice. That's like the company, like that's the ethical, like 100%. I'm not sure if I'm hired somewhere, they can use my data, but that's the, like you could sue the company, like if they do this. So that's the purpose, and that purpose must be clear described to the user in a plain language, not legalized. So that is a privacy notice, like you see in the notice boards. Normally in a university, like this is our privacy notice. In our companies, we find that, okay, your data would not be sent, or your credit card details would not be sent to someone else. And you check that. So that's a privacy notice. Impact assessment. So a data protection impact assessment is a process designed to identify the risk of collecting and processing personal data in the context of a business workflow or project, to identify mechanisms that mitigate those risks. So this is a very cool topic, that is impact assessment. Basically, normally I take a lot of time on this, but because like this is just a shorter class, so impact, like there is something known as cost and there's something known as impact. In our, again, I will talk about the real world and real example. Like if you work somewhere, example, you are working for HP, so you will go over there and you will say that hey boss, this is your manager. For example, Derek is my manager. I will go to Derek. Hey boss, we are facing a lot of threats. We need to buy a new firewall. And the new firewall should be of Palo Alto, or you can buy for Fortinet or any of the firewall you like. So we need to buy a firewall. That's urgent. If you don't buy a firewall, so our company data would be affected and our company would be on a high risk. So your manager will say to you that, okay, create a documentation. So normally that we do, like we create a documentation that is known as impact assessment. So what I will do, like I will just create a documentation that for 1 year, I will just do quickly this, like for 1 year, we have like 10 million threats. It's like in every 6 months, they're increasing to 100 million threats. So our systems are not good enough to protect this. So we need to buy a new firewall. So if we buy a new firewall, so we will make sure that our threats are secure. Our system is not on a risk anymore. So this would be a flow that you will create, that you need a firewall just to make sure that you are mitigating the risk. Mitigating means that you are reducing the risk. Mitigation techniques are there. You are reducing the risk, that okay, let's reduce the risk. Data retention, I've already talked about this, like you retain a data, you create a data for some time, that you use the data, then finally you retain that data for specific period of time. And after that, for example, there are company, they retain the data for 10 years. There are company, they retain a data for only 1 year. There are company who retain the data for 1 week or only a month. So totally depends upon the company policies, like how much they require to retain the data. So that is known as data retention. Data sovereignty and geographical consideration. So data sovereignty is jurisdiction. So like you need to make sure the data is independent. Like jurisdictions means like it's like judges, like the judiciary is involved. So you make sure that your data is under the law control, and if there's something goes wrong, so you can directly go for the court probes. GDPR and the location of the data. So GDPR is basically used for our EU EU areas, like for the location, like for example, someone is traveling from Paris, from France to Spain, from Spain to UK. So they require that their data should be safe. So under the Europe, basically it says that as for whole Europe, obey our policies for the data sovereignty. So we will protect your data. You just like, you need to tell us that company have to inform and should follow their policy. These are basically the policies that when we are deploying our data policy in our organization, when we deploy DLP, remember I'm talking about DLP is very important. When you deploy DLP policies, like just again, guys, note it down on your notepads, Office 365. That is the exchange, like that's the online exchange now, like Office 65 for email. Just search in Office, Microsoft MS Office 65, search DLP policy. So you will find some policies over there, just in a Google, you will find quickly. So you can just search it. Same goes for these are the policies. Geographical consideration, this is one of the important thing, like whenever you are, like if you just take an example of Amazon, let me just like see like what time it is, that we do have time. So if you talk about Amazon AWS, the biggest good thing about Amazon is that Amazon is divided into regions. Why we divide this one into region? Because for example, there is a region that normally I like work, that is Virginia one. You can just have a region. You can have a region in London. You can have a region in, for example, Beijing. You have three regions. What I can do, I can just put my few database that is known as replication over here, database one, database two, and database three. I can put everywhere. For example, God forbid something happened in Virginia, so I can move my over here. I can just collect my data from Beijing. If something goes here, I can collect my data from London. So that is the consideration of geographical, like you can divide your data for the region wise. If you take an example of cloud world, and even the employee access, like over here, this is again a huge thing to remember, like employee access means like, when we talk about the geographical consideration, for example, you guys are in Riyadh or you are in Saudi, there are somebody is like over here, we have Derek, he is working from, for example, Africa. I'm working from Asia, from Pakistan. There's someone working from US. We are like Franklin, like this is the employee access, like every region is divided and the employee access is for their own region consideration. So for example, if I'm working for Russia, for example, in Russia, our xyz.com, remember our company xyz.com, guys, our company xyz.com would have a different type of mindset, like different type of a mindset when they are working for Russia, for the Russian client. And if you work for China, we have a different mindset. If you're working for Saudis, we have a different mindset. If you're working for Asians, we have a different mindset. For US, UK, for everyone, for Japan, we have a different. So the employee access and the employee mindset should be set correctly. That's divided into region. So again, guys, note it down quickly. I will just quickly finish this up. We have different regions. One is known as US, one is known as EMEAR, one is known as APJC in our world. US means North America, South America. EMEAR means that is the Europe, Middle East, E for Europe, M for Middle, and E for East, and A for Africa, EMEAR, and R for region. EMEAR region, APJC, that is the Asia, Pacific, Japan continent. So we normally works region-wise. So different policies of our data. Cloud-based solution, I've just told you about the Amazon, like how you can create a region. Guys, any question clear? Clear, everyone? Clear, guys, speak to me. Clear, clear, clear. Come on, guys, everyone, shout like this. Clear, clear, clear. Yes, please. Thank you, thank you. I feel good. There's a song, I feel good. So I feel good right now. Thank you, guys, thank you. So clear, clear, just put clear, just put a Y. That's quite enough for me that you guys are there. So that's quite enough. Perfect, perfect. Thank you, everyone. I know, like, I'm not, like, I'm talking too much, giving too much information. I'm sorry about that, but because I really, really want, whatever, like, it's my second week over here. I'm also new to this coding dojo right now. I teach, like, to the training, to the normal, corporate people a lot, and B2B clients. So that when I got this opportunity, so I just thought that this was even better for me, because I really want our generations that they get into the learning process of IT, because the world is evolving a lot very quickly. So I will be teaching you a lot way, like a real world will be a lot of involved in this, just to make sure that when you sit on that hot chair at the time of the interview, when you finish this bootcamp, so at least for a once minute, you just realize that, okay, there was an associate instructor, Mohammad Hussain, he told us that, okay, this was something. So when you're working, so you should remember that, okay, he taught me this term, that was POC, yeah, so you should remember. Okay, Amazon region-wise, he taught us something like that, yes. Okay, PCI, yeah, he taught us that, okay, this would implement here. So that would be like an achievement for me. So I believe that you guys just, like, be energetic, talk to me, and we can continue. Like, this is just a today's session. 2 days I will be teaching. Lloyd is a very good instructor, he will be back. So that will keep me at least alive, that you guys are talking to me. So anyways, so guys, privacy breaches and data breaches. So organization consequences, if breach is there, okay, xyz.com is in trouble now, guys. xyz.com is in trouble. We guys are in trouble. We are a consultant company, we are in trouble. So in that scenario, how we will react? So we are in trouble and there's a breach. There was a successful breach that has been done now already. So what the problem is that the reputation damage, like there is a reputation damage, our company xyz.com is now, everybody is saying, okay, this company, yeah, this is a bad company. We don't like them. Like our data is not secure. There are some banks, like when there was a breach, so a lot of people stop putting their money in that bank. So they say that, okay, we don't trust this bank anymore. Reputation, they have lost their reputation. Identity theft, like when someone steals your personal information to commit fraud. So there could be someone like, I just copy the identity of, for example, Derek, or I just copy the identity of Ruba or Rima. So like I can become someone else. I can change my gender. I just show that, okay, I'm this. So I started to work and I steal something, good information. So that is also the consequences. Fines, there's a penalty. Like if I am a consultant company, if I do something wrong, so the company, like we sign an SLA, service level agreement. If you don't provide the services, if you don't provide this, so we will fine you. We will deduct your payment. That's really happened. That really happens. And we will not pay you. So that are the fines. Normally in a corporate, we do have fines. IP theft, guys, IP theft is your intellectual property. For example, that's like I'm teaching you guys. I train people. Basically, I train. Let's not teach. The training is for CompTIA Plus, Network Plus, Security Plus, and IT, CCNA, and Amazon. And normally, I train for the product Palo Alto. Different. So that's my property. That's my intellectual property. Even I didn't go through these slides a lot, but I just go through. That's my own property. So nobody can take it. So same goes for in the development world. Developers, if some developer creates some good developing code on, for example, on .NET, so that's their property. They sign that and they say that that's our software house. You cannot take it. So if there is a threat, somebody have took that, and you can just file a case against them. So that's a theft. Notification of a breach, that can be put on the social media these days and can be on websites, can be on electronic media, that okay, this company xyz.com has compromised, they have lost their so important data of their customer from everywhere, and there was a ransomware, for example WannaCry was there, and they have given like million of dollar to that attacker. So that's a bad thing. So a notification would be there that we are sorry, this would not happen to the customers. 90% this notification breaches for the stakeholders. Who is a stakeholder? Whoever is attached with you, they are considered as stakeholders. Escalation, yes, if the fines are not enough, so you can escalate that matter to judge, judiciary, or you can escalate that matter to courtroom. Any stakeholder will say that, okay, you have done this wrong, so I will sue you and we will take you to the courtroom. Public notification disclosure, so you can either publicly notify this that, okay, we have a breach and we are dissolving xyz.com, or you can disclosure. There are agreements that we normally say you can disclose it that, okay, we got, or sometime a lot of company, they even don't tell you that we got a breach and there was a threat and there was an outrage. So like most of the company doesn't tell this, but still, like, if the market is very high and people knows this, so they tell. So now data sharing and privacy terms. So like Derek, are you there? So like, are we ready for the break? Let's take a quick break, guys. 10 minutes or 15 minutes break. Then we'll be back, or like we can just go for more. Like 15. Yeah, I know everyone is getting tired, sleepy, or somebody is getting angry as well. Like, why he's talking too much? So let's take a break for 15 minutes. So let's, guys, quickly grab a cup of coffee, tea, soda, if you like. I don't drink these days. I'm getting fat. So get something, drink water. I will be back in 15 minutes exactly. Thank you guys for listening to me. I was talking about Derek.
Like, all right.
Is he yeah. there?
Yes, I just the recording.
Okay. Yeah. Hey, Derek. Like, what is this tea?
I think.
Arika. Arika.
Yeah, Arika. Arika is a mule, I think.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, some of the group members convinced me to try it out. So we've been fighting over the best foods in Saudi Arabia. And
oh.
So I sort of brought it up. So that's Arika. And then there's Kapsa. There's Kapsa. Yeah. There's Mugogo, something like that. You know.
Yeah, but it's good. Yes, thank you,
Pastor. Yes, that's it.
Okay, Burgog. Okay. Okay, so when we will visit, like, and we will try this. And there's a good food as well of Saudi, that is mandi. Like I have tried mandi, like mutton mandi is really nice.
Ooh,
yeah, that's really nice. Yeah, it's.
But then what I had was. Like what I heard was mandi kapsa, so I was confused. Ah. Some people were like kapsa, some were like mandi, then mandi kapsa. So
okay, mandi is nice. So like you put a leg piece of a mutton or a lamb, and there are rice underneath, so you just eat it, and that's really something good. Mandi is one type of kubasa. Okay, thank you, Abdullah. So we will learn the food from our students now, like our family and friends, they will help us. Kabasa, yeah. Okay. So we can just do. I will ask you important questions. Like after this lecture, we can just have a chit chat about it. I told you that when you come to Saudi Arabia, I will be the best restaurant for Saudi. Oh, thank you, Ibrahim. Like a good invitation. What about me, Ibrahim? Should I'm invited? Okay, this is valid for only Derek.
Yeah, I think. I've already paid my dues. I've already chosen places I'm going to visit. So now, for now, I come from about 4 different cities in Saudi Arabia. So.
Oh, perfect. Okay. Perfect. I hope everyone is getting ready now. Like everyone have a cup of tea or arika. So let's get started, guys. Thank you. So, okay, this champion form that you need to fill up, that Derek is saying. So, that's a reminder, guys. Now, let's get started with our lecture, that is data sharing privacy term of agreement. Whenever we are working for any organization, we do have agreements. One of the common agreement is service level agreement that you normally sign with, just an example, ISPs. Those are the internet service provider. For example, you are, again, let's talk about xyz.com. We are a company and we are the employee, like there are 10 employees or 100. For example, we have 50 employees. So we required a specific bandwidth for our organization. So what we need to do, we will buy the internet from our ISPs. So there will be an agreement, and that agreement will say that, okay, for every, like there will be no downtime. The biggest problem with our ISPs is that there's something known as downtime. Downtime is very effective in our organizations. Like for example, if there's a downtime and they say that our internet would be there for 99.9999% would be there. So that means like for annual, we are talking about annual. So that the downtime will not be more than 30 minutes. That's the agreement. If we reduce 19, so then it will increase to, for example, 300 minutes. If we reduce 19 or we eliminate 19, so it will reduce to 3000 minutes per year. If we again minus 19, so that means like 30,000 minutes. So you can just see how much effective it is downtime in our real world. Normally we calculate it per monthly basis, that we have a chart. We just create a chart. That's a normal spreadsheet chart. Like, okay, today we have a downtime for this. Is a speed test always running, or you can just run a speed test app, or you can just have a speed test using the bandwidth checkers. For example, we do have an option in our SolarWinds. So that's the agreement that we have with the ISP, SLA. So SLA is very important because that's the service level agreement that we will provide the services to you guys who is buying the agreement. We have another agreement that is known as ISA, that is Interconnection Security Agreement. And any federal agency interconnecting its IT system to a third party must create an ISA to the govern the relationship. So that's an agreement between the government and the agency. So like I've never signed this one, but SLA is a common. NDA is like more common, like we normally sign, like Cisco. I have signed for Cisco. Even for over here for Coding Dojo, I've signed this thing. Like there was a clause for NDA. That's a non-disclosure agreement. It's an agreement that says that, okay, you will not retrieve our confidential data outside. I'm working from home, and if there are some important data of Coding Dojo, as an ethics, I'm not allowed to take that data outside. So that's an agreement. And if I do this, I will be dragged in the courtroom. So like I need to be careful, like when we are talking about NDAs, like how important it is. Data sharing use agreement. So we do have different agreements, guys, like AUP, that is known as acceptable user policy, like how much internet you can use, like you can note it down in your notepad. You can go through AUPs, like how you can, how much internet, what asset you can use, how much internet speed, what websites you can visit. So there are more agreements in day to day that we sign. That's a normal day to day task of, this has been done by the HR department, like the NDA, AUPs, and normal onboarding process, offboarding process. Giving the asset is a part of the IT guys. Like when somebody is a new fresh is hired, for example, I'm hired in Coding Dojo. So they have created my user account on Gmail. They have created and they have given the password, Zoom, they have given me, and we have different channels. Like for example, Mattermost, they have given me. So whenever you join a new organization, normally there's an onboarding process and offboarding process. So we normally have, now they have created my account. When I leave this company, so they will remove my account and they will shut down my account, take all of the access off. So that's the user agreement. Like we have a lot of agreements that we can have. Data protection, data are always in three states. You can say that these are the data in rest, three states. One state is known as rest, resting state. One is known as transiting state. And one is known as use. The most important where you need to make sure that the data should be secured is the use one. So these are the state, like always, like just like state in our liquid. Let's talk about physics. Liquid is in three state. Like water, not let's talk water. Water is in three state. One state of water is solid. That is the water you drink. Then there is a liquid that is like water. That's a liquid. That's a water we have. Solid is ice. Liquid is water that we drink. And finally, we have gas. That's the three state that we have in physics. So similarly, data, we have three states we have set: rest, transit, and use. Rest state is that you have a data and you have a folder C drive folder documents. Documents, you have that data is not in use. You have just kept that data that is not normally used. So you just keep that data in the document file. That is considered as data in rest. What you can do, you can just encrypt that data using BitLockers. You can note it down BitLockers, or you can just buy a software like McAfee or Symantec or Bitdefender is one of the good free one these days. That's free. Bitdefender, you can just download that and you can encrypt that C document. So your whole, you can even encrypt the whole drive as well for the data protection. So that is known as a data in rest. You can use ACLs as well. Like ACLs are the policies that you can create that you say that, okay, this there will be only CEO will only access this data, otherwise no one else, or only the IT guys will access the data, otherwise no one can access that data. So that is known as data in rest, and that's encrypted by, you can use the Bitdefender or you can have the access control list to protect that data. We have a data in transit, that is like the data is moving, is in a moving form. So how the data is moving, guys? For example, we have a web server. This is a web server. This is IAM. I want to visit www.againourcompanyxyz.com. I'm sitting in Saudi Arabia and I am in Riyadh, for example, and my web server is in London. So I will go on the internet. I will just put this URL And the URL will hit my web server directly by the directions, you know, how the routing works. So it will directly comes to the web server over here. When it jumps to this web server, so what will happen? Because my web server, guys, this is very important, note it down. My web server is having certificates that we call HTTPS. When you install certificates in your web server, that web server will convert from HTTP traffic from port 80, it will be converted to port number 443. That means S is included. That means your traffic is secure now. So my web server, I'm a good company. I have HTTPS traffic. So that server is there. So that so we have certificates. So normally you see a lock sign ahead in your URL. So those are the HTTPS certificates. So what will happen? There will be a tunnel will be created in between the internet, between my connection and this web server. So this is the HTTPS traffic. The whole traffic would be encrypted. Normally that is known as TLS certificate or SSL TLS 1.3 these days, or IPsec. This is the VPN that also you can use. So a tunnel is encrypted. So this is known as, because I am talking to the web server is responding me back. So that means like this is encryption is included. So that is known as a data in transit. You are transiting the data from one end, just like a transit. I want to visit Saudi. I want to visit, for example, Franklin to California. So there's a transit file. I'm transiting from Dubai, for example, and then there's a transit to London. Then there's a transit to California. So that means I'm moving. So that's a moving data. That's a data in transit. Data in use, this is the most volatile data still till date that I will just, that's my own understanding. That's a data in use because that's the data is in the RAM right now, because that you're not sure because the RAM is working. You have nothing to protect the RAM right now, but we have a trusted executor environment TEE, or you can create a TPM. That's a trusted platform module. You can create like we normally create for our hard drive. We can create. So, but still, as per, again, that's not the understanding like the book says, but as per my own understanding, this data can be like, there could be an issue. So over here, there are different software guard can encrypt your data while in the RAM. So this data, because the RAM data is always in use right now, I'm sharing this PowerPoint. So there's a RAM is using, RAM is in use right now because RAM is keeping the memory. The memory is being picked up from the Microsoft PowerPoint, it is kept in RAM. So when I shared my other slide, so that's already in RAM right now because RAM have the access of that PowerPoint. That's a memory, random access memory. So, but when I turn it back, so all this, you know, this pen will be gone. So that's gone. So I still believe like this data in use is little bit still like there are issues. Data exfiltration, I was talking about DLP. So you have a problem with the data loss first thing. Like that's the most important thing. Like somebody is entering in an environment and they take a picture. So that's not allowed. They take audio. That's not allowed. So, and they just take some paper, some HR important paper. So that is loss of the data or known as data exfiltration. So copying the data to the removal media, like you can just copy something that's not allowed and you're doing that using a network protocol. You can use some protocol by communicating it overly or a telephone or use a picture or a video of data. So the most important thing is that when you are putting a policy or when you are implementing a policy in a network, just make sure that that's out of band and the DLPs are there and telephones are also monitored. Mobile phones, MDM is monitored. One of the important coolest thing that you should make sure that there's a there is a swipe like that. There's a kill swipe. Everything like you should restrict things like nobody can take the data off your network. Make sure everything is encrypted. Protection practices. So what we can do? We can encrypt the data. Ensure that all the sensitive data is encrypted at rest, as I've told you, like use BitLockers, Bitdefenders, McAfee, any of these third-party software. So you can just make sure your C drive, your D drive, your E drive, or your documents are encrypted. That folder is encrypted. And nobody can open that folder until and unless administrator allows that. create and maintain offsite backups. There are different type of backups, like we normally have offsite backups, like there is something known as a physical offsite WOM. You can just write it down, WOM. Like I will just come into your labs if you want to go into this topic. WOM site, we have a hot site and we have a cold site. So that is the offsite data we normally create. Or you can say offsite also means like that's not on premises. You are backing up in the cloud, or you're backing up physically to some other city. So that's the protection that we can do. Train users about document confidentiality. One of the biggest problem, guys, you will join the organization, is your own employees. They are not trained enough. They just download something that's not allowed, or they forward something that's not allowed. So you should train your users, train your employees, tell them like how the documentation works. Use host-based access list. Yes, totally. Yes, Ibrahim. So that's host-based access list. Like, just to cover a bit about like Ibrahim told, yes. So just a little bit over here too. So what social engineering attack is still the most famous attack. You know why? Because I will just make a fool of someone. I'm a hacker. The most important information that I want would be from inside threat. There would be someone, there will be an involvement of someone inside, then the information will come outside. Otherwise it won't be that easy. So again, that is the confidential information. Use host-based ACS. Host-based ACS, like guys, you know your host-based firewall. Your host-based firewall, just type in your Windows system, write firewall. There will be a setting, advanced firewall. That's your host-based firewall. And there are some inbound and outbound rules. You can just open some ports. If you want to close some ports, just add a new rule, directly go. I normally used to do this like in 5 or 6 in back. So directly clear a rule that, okay, 1101. 1101 is a port number that is used for SQL. We used to stop SQL services. Stop SQL or allow SQL for that specific laptop such that the SQL is installed. So you can just create your own rules. Okay, I was just talking about since today I'm talking about DLP. DLP is important, data loss prevention. You need to make sure your data is prevented. Your data is not lost. So endpoint agents, like again, just like our McAfee, just like our Symantec, just like our Cisco endpoints. How can I forget? Cisco will kill me. Cisco endpoints, those are the agents. Those are installed in the network, installed on your laptops, just to make sure that your data is not lost and nobody is like doing something fishy in your laptops. So endpoints are agents. They are something known as agent-based. There's also something known as agentless. Agentless means you don't download any agent or any end user. Like for example, brxyz.com have 100 employees. So I will not download anything, any McAfee on the laptops. I will have an agentless. I will just have an endpoint at my server and I will control from there. Like whoever come inside, I will give the access. Whoever joins the organization, otherwise I won't be giving access. So that's agentless. There's a topic for that. So agent, like 90%, not more than 95%, we download agents for the endpoints. Policy server, there's a policy server we can create. That's a NAC. We can create a policy server as a NAC. Like they are, you can search it on the internet, NAC. They are the network access control. Yeah, that's the acronym, I believe. Maybe if I'm forgetting, you can Google it. So they enforce the policy. They say that, okay, you join my organization, it's fine, but you need to obey us. You need to follow the policies. You are not allowed to use internet, or you're not allowed to use Facebook, like whoever you are. You have to follow our policies. You cannot upload anything or you cannot download anything. You're not allowed to use cameras. You're not allowed to use, for example, WhatsApp calls. So that's our own policy. We create a policy server that is known as NAC, is the most common server that we normally use for enforcing. That's known as enforcing the policies. Enforcers are put in the firewall. In the real world, you put the enforcer over there, they enforce the policy. To configure classification, confidentiality, privacy rules and policy, log incidents and compile reports. So policy servers are there, guys, in the real world. NACA is one of the best policy servers, which is putting the pressure, and they're telling that you need to follow our rules. And we also have log file SIMs are there for maintaining logs. Network agent, so to scan communication at network borders and interface with the web messaging servers to enforce policy. Network agent is 90% is your firewall, or that can become your router where you put the policy, where you implement the policy of your DLP. For example, in our, I don't know what the time is right now, but yes, we do have time. So just a quick example over here, what the policies, how the policies are implemented. This is your DMZ. In the DMZ, there's a firewall over here. This is the internet. There's a traffic comes through the firewall, and there's a ESA email servers over here. We have a policy for our email that is implemented in our email server that nobody in, like, whenever we receive any email, nobody is allowed to have a PDF file in their email, whatever the attachment they have. If they find any attachment for the PDF or for the macros, it's a better example for the macros. That's an attack. Like, we do have macros in our Excel file. So if we have anything Excel file, we do have macros. Macros enabled files are there. Remember, very important term, guys, again, note it down. Macros enabled Excel files are there. So what this ESA will do, it will remove it or put that file in quarantine for the administrative. The security guy, the cyber security guy will come over here. They will go to this quarantine then. And the message will be delivered to the end user. For example, the message was for Ibrahim. So Ibrahim just see the message that, okay, there was an attachment. Where's my attachment? He will directly file a case in the help desk, ask. Help desk guy will say that, hey, wait, that's for the security purpose. We have removed that macro enable file. We need to check that file. So that's the network agent. Basically, that agent is at the border of your network. In the DMZ, you can place your email gateways. You do the same practice for your web servers as well. So that's how you enforce a policy. Over here, you can put a NAC as well. So NAC will enforce the rest of the policies. So guys, any question, anything clear, guys, everyone alive? Or too quick? Why? Just put why quickly. Everyone is alive. Thank you. Any question, getting any confusion, guys, please ask me if any questions are there. So I will help you. Like, I know there's a lot of dumping of knowledge is there right now, but that's why I told you, open notepad. Any question, I will be in the labs today for 2 or 3 days. So coming on and off, so we can discuss a bit more theory then. Clear, perfect. Thank you, guys. Respond me. Smiley faces, everyone. That's a joke. So just leave it. Okay, everyone is there. That's the important thing. Thank you. So this will make me happy and make me in energy that you guys are there with me. So normally, like, thank you, Nora. Thank you, Sumaya. Like, thank you, guys. Thank you. Help. Please, smiley faces are good, so I can smile as well, and I can teach you more and more. I will, like, give you torture. So let's get going now with our next topic, rights management services. So rights, as we have talked about, rights are, like, maybe you have talked in the previous chapters or in your previous bootcamp sites. Lloyd must have gone through this. So there are the file, there's a folder. You right click the folder and you will find an option that what permissions that you will give. Permissions are read, write, execute, and these are the permission, read, write, execute, and one more, maybe I'm missing. So these are the permission, like, you can read the document, you can write anything, or you can execute the document. So that's the permissions that we normally give the to the documents or to our files. Restrict printing and forwarding. So for no access, yes, thank you. So that's the no access as well, you can provide. Restrict printing and forwarding of the document. You can restrict someone that, okay, you can, guys, I'm not sure, like, how much you know about the Active Directory. Anyone knows about the Active Directories, group policies of your DNS server? 90% you will find this in your real environment. group policies. 90% we have a group policies in our network. We create a group of policies for different departments in our network. For example, sales department, marketing department. Okay, HR guys are only allowed. This has really happened in our network. HR guys are only allowed to print. That's bad. I hate these things. But I was IT guy. I 6 or 7 years back, I need to do that. So the HR guys are only allowed to print the document. Our innocent sales team, management team, and our other teams were not allowed to print anything. So at that time, that was a thing. So the HR guys, this group policies for the HR guys were only allowed to print. Rest of the policy we used to make that we stop that you are not allowed to print anything. So this is a policy. We can do the same thing for our documents, right? Related, just check like that. Are you allowed to print something or you're not allowed? Restrict printing, forwarding the email messages. That's the same policies we can do. Group policies, guys, if you have time, you can just check the active directories and in our Windows, because mostly we in our real network, Windows are very, very commonly used. So you must be familiar with the group policies, active directories, how you set up the quotas, and how you restrict the messages. There are in the security policies of group policies, there are 1,000 policies. You can stop someone using USB. You can stop someone using printer. You can stop someone using command prompt. You can stop someone using PowerShell. You can stop someone delivering the email message. Like a lot of things are there in our active directory and group policies. Anyways, so configure and implement rights management template. Those templates are already predefined in our Windows world. So you don't need to do a lot. There is a template. You just take that template, implement that. That's it. You don't have to change. There is something known as allow or deny. So you can just allow or deny. That's like the policy that you want to allow, just allow it. That's all. That's a very simple process, but still you should know like what how the group policies work in our real life, in the real world. Privacy enhancing technology. So how we can enhance our technologies. So de-identification. So you like, what is that? That's a method may also be used where personal data is collected to perform a transaction, but not need to retain thereafter. So that's a dead, like whenever there's a compromise or whenever there's a privacy. So we make sure that the identification, there's a no de-identification. Like I have gone through some path. I just take that file path, copy it. Like that's like, there was something in C drive documents, and in documents there was a folder, for example, Derek, and Derek have some useful file. If I have that path, so that would be a problem. So you need to make sure that you are de-identification is there. You are not making sure that the path is not defined. Similar example, if we have a path, so you can mask your data as well. That's a tokenization that we normally do. So that's a de-identification. There are two options that we normally use in de-identification. One is fully anonymized data. A fully anonymized data is one where individual subjects can no longer identify even if the data is combined with the other data source. So Derek was the folder. Derek was used to go to that data, but now data is like the rights has been taken again. So Derek cannot check that data anymore. So that's one thing. Can you at some point also at some point, please? Okay, guys, I will just do it, Franklin. So there's something known as pseudo anonymization. So modifier replaces identifying information so that re-identification depends on alternate. Same thing, like if Derek wants to go to his folders again, so he need to re-identify his data. So that's one thing to remember. Also, re-identification attack is one that combines a de-identified data set with the other data source, such as the public voter records, like to discover how secure the de-identification method is used. Key anomalous information is the data that can be linked to or more individual. So Derek and I can review that files. This means the data does not ambiguously re-identify specific individual, but there is a significant risk of re-identification given the value of K. So obviously this is a risky. I don't prefer these methods, like Derek can only like that the data identification or the data deduplication is one of the biggest problems. But as an administrator, as a security guy, just always remember to don't give a group of permissions to everyone. Like normally this is the mistake that we do. Like if there is a very sensitive data, we are talking about privacy. So if there is a high privacy, so don't involve a group, don't involve multiple users to accept that data. Always give a single right to the single person. We have a data de-identification methods. You can go for the data masking. Like normally we have something like there's a document, like in the document you find words. So in the words, you will find the XXXXX signs. So that is known as a data masking. So that content, like what is there in the notepad or in the Word file, that is like masked. And there's an X written over there all the way. So nobody else can see that data of Derek's file. Like that was a Derek's folder and there was a Derek's file. So nobody can see that file because that file is basically having a data masking. So what is that? Data masking can mean that all or a part of a contents of a field are re-indexed, but substituting all character strings with X, for example. So there will be X in all of the sheet. So nobody can see. Tokenization, that's like quite similar, but means that all or the part of the data in a field is replaced with a randomly generated token. So now we were not having X anymore. There could be E, B, A, C, S, sign, dollar, or anything. So that's a tokenization, like they are replaced by the random tokens. Aggregation banding, another de-identification technique is to generalize the data, such as substituting a specific age or a broader age band. So like you can just take a string, that's basically string. You take a string, put a new string, or a broader age bands are used. There's something known as hashing and sorting. Because guys, these are the huge topics. Like hashing is a very huge topic. I pretty much show like everyone have a concept for the hashing, guys. Everyone. Yeah. Like if I'm 99%. Lloyd must have cleared your concept, but still if you have a little 1%, you can just ask me in the break right now. I will not go a lot over here because we will get short of time. I will go through the break about the theory. So okay, perfect, good job guys. So that we can do. Okay, so hashing is something like we have an hash algorithms that we normally use for the hashing purpose, and those hashing is a one-way encryption that you normally work. There are different algorithms. We don't use MD5 anymore. So in the real world, the most popular at the moment till 2021 September is SHA-256. That's the hash that we are normally using. We do have 512, but we are not using it. 90% Cisco, at least, they are using SHA-256 in their Cisco Talos cloud. That's the cloud where there are a lot of malwares. So hashing is a very important term. Salting. What the salting is, you must have gone through this as well, but just a quick revision. Like, for example, there is a word that we are writing, hello. How you can salt this in hello? You will put something over here, changing the hash value. Yes. You can just solve this, like how the hash value could be changed. Like you can just put one over here, two, then L, then four, five, then again one L, then seven, then O. This is salting. You are adding some digits such that when you run the algorithm, yes. When you run the algorithm, so the hash value of this hello and this hello would be changed. So the new hash will be there. So when you again check it, like because like whenever and random character, yes, that's the right, excellent. That's a random character that you are ending when you are doing the salting. There's something known as NOS as well. There's something known as IV as well, guys. Like that's the random number we add, and there's IV. In our real world, we use IV a lot. Salting is also used, and salt, we normally salt our passwords. Passwords, guys, just again note it down. 90% passwords, not 90%, 100% passwords are in hashes. Hashes. Your password is in a plain text, but the hash is like it's converted into a hash value like a string. So how to check, like you put your password, it will go to, for example, in Linux, it will go to the etc shadow. I'm not sure about Kali because I don't use Kali a lot, but in a Linux, like they are in the shadow folder, and in our Windows world is they are in the SAM. So it just check the values. If the value is same, you are allowed to enter. So that's the hashing, and the passwords are safe. Salting, already you guys are familiar with the term. So you can just put a random character and the value of the hash is changed. Now let's talk a bit. What we have talked today, we have talked a lot and about the data privacy and what the data privacy actually is. So guidelines for the data privacy, what we have talked about privacy, privacy and protection. Privacy is very important. Any sensitive data that is there, that could be the data of our contact details, that could be a data of our email, that could be a data of our account details, that could be a data of our payrolls. So that data should be set correctly, should be protected. So there are different methods that you can protect the data. You can change the data owner, you can restrict them, nobody can use that data. Ensure that the confidential and the personal data is classified and managed using an information lifecycle model. So the lifecycle model that we have discussed today was like you create something first, then you use it, then you retain it, and then finally you dispose it off. So that's the information lifecycle. Normally 90% we are using this lifecycle. After that, develop classification for confidential and personal information based on standard descriptors such as public, private, sensitive, confidential, critical, proprietary, PII, health information, PHI, PCI, customer data. So we have talked a lot about this, that those are the personal information, and those are normally used in our network. For example, the customer information is very important. SSN numbers, social security numbers are important. Your PII information is very important. Your PCI, your payment card industry standards are very important. And even your own email ID is important. Your passport detail is important. Your proprietary information, like if you have written any of the code, or if you are publishing any book, if you are an author, so that information is very important. And that's why we classify our information into different categories, that could be public, that for everyone, private, that's for your own self, sensitive, that's your personally own self, very sensitive information, confidential information, that's for your company, company's confidential information is there, critical information we do have. So proprietary, just like Apple, we have a proprietary, just like Microsoft. Or if you develop any application, so that's proprietary, that's your own. Health information, already talked about this. So those are the PHI, that's your personal health information that is being used. Make impact assessments for breach events and identify notification and reporting requirements. So make impact, that means like you are creating a report. Like a cost and impact are directly proportional in our real world. So obviously, if you want to make an impact in your real life, like you guys are over here studying, that's you want to change your life, you want to make an impact to your life. So the cost will be involved always. That's a very important term, like not only for IT, but cost is, in our normal terms, we normally say cost is directly proportional to impact. So how the cause, guys, can everyone, just for the attendance purpose, like, guys, can everyone in our class can put the, raise their hands, please? Sorry, I'm disturbing you all. I know this is summary. Raise your hand, Abdullah, raise your hand. Everyone in the classroom, please raise your hand. This is just like a concert. Like we normally go to somewhere, raise your hand. Like this, raise your hand. So guys, raise your hand, raise everyone. Thank you, Nora. Everyone, guys, raise your hand in the Zoom such that we, at least we can just judge like who is sleeping. So I don't have an emoji. Oh, really? So you need to update your Zoom, I believe.
No, you should have it. You should have it. If you look underneath you, under your Zoom, there's a button that says reaction. You click on that reaction and then you can. By the way, who said they don't have emojis? Because the rest, it looks like so many people are not even raising their hands, which means they are not present in class. So I'll take a screenshot of those who have raised their hands and I'll mark them present. Anyone else will be absent.
Oh, yeah, Saad, can you please raise your hand in that Zoom reaction? Where is the Zoom reaction?
Yeah. Derek, please take note and take a screenshot of your class and make sure anyone that is not present in class should be marked absent.
Sure.
All right, thank you.
Thanks, Franklin. So guys, that was our Mr. Franklin. So going back over here to our summary. So cost and impact. That's a very important thing in our real world, in our real life as well. How the costs and impact work together, basically. For example, you guys are studying over here. And for example, you're paying for this bootcamp and you must be, I'm not sure how it works, but for example, you are paying for this bootcamp, for example, $100, for example. So that is the cost is involved. How impact it would be there in your life? My host device is Ubuntu, cannot find. Okay, Ubuntu she's using. So Franklin, Derek, can anyone? Ubuntu is a Linux system. So, but that should be in Zoom. Okay, Derek, can you just make a note for Haya? Like she cannot have the emoji and she's having problem. Okay.
It's okay, Derek. Take note of her. And in 1 minute, if anybody doesn't put their hands up, then just take a screenshot and everyone can put their hands down.
All right.
So sorry about that, guys. So that is a normal procedure of our classes day to day. So we need to make sure that everyone is there listening, like open the laptop, sleeping. So this could happen. So the cost. Now, if you are paying $100, this is just for your guys to understand like how your real life work as well. If you pay $100 for your study, so it will directly impact your life. How it could impact your life? So you will start studying. That could make you like more literate. You are more there now and you are there to, you know, defense force attendance. I'm not sure what is that, but that's like you would have the more impact on your life. For example, there is something in our real life, in our IT world, just guys note it down, there's something known as CI. CI. CI is known as a continuous improvement register that we normally use. 90% in when you join any organization, so what happened, like they ask you that you need to, because you are in IT field, so you need to make sure that you improve all the time. So that we consider as a continuous improvement. So we say that, okay, you have a quarterly period, like for example, September, October, November, or from October, November, December. At the end of the year, you need to have a certification on, for example, on Computer Security Plus. So you need to make sure that you have a certification for that. Why we do that? That's a continuous improvement process that you need to. Now you will spend some money on that certification, and that's a cost is involved. That impact is there, that you will learn something from Computer Security Plus, and it will give an impact on your job, that you will learn something and you will start implementing on that. So always remember, cost and impact are directly proportional. It's like whatever you invest and whatever you're investing. For example, you're investing in your vehicle, you're modifying your car, so that you putting a cost that will impact the speed. You are like you have installed a booster in your car, or a like a modifier, like if you are driving a vehicle, you have changed the shocks of your vehicle. For example, you are using Tacoma, Toyota Tacoma. It's very, very nice vehicle actually. So you have changed the shocks, King shocks you have put, like they are quite expensive. So that's like the cost and impact. So that will help you to drive in a rally or drive and go for a desert surfing, like safari. So that's like how cost and impact works. Now back to our topic, make impact assessments for breach events and identify notification and reporting requirements. Use a content management system that enables classification tagging of a file and record. So you should have you should have a logging system that could be in-house made software, or that could be anything like whatever you have. So you can just log files over there. Normally, if you talk about Windows system, that's an event manager or an event viewer we normally use. So over there, there's a logs, and logs are there. Logs are basically, guys, again, noted down this thing, logs are known as WOM. WOM. What WOM stands for? Written once, read many. Logs will be written only once. Like this is a log. I'm teaching you this log now. Let's log. I started a class at 9 and I will finish a class like in after half an hour. That's my log. Now I cannot go back to the time, change something. So you write once and you read my time, but I can read this log for 100 times that this was a time I have gone through and this was the lectures I've gone through. So that's read many times. So that's WOM. And normally that's why the hackers and the attackers, they basically target the log files a lot. So when they retreat at the time of the botnet, when the botnet is done, when they retreat the systems, so 90% a good attacker, they change the log files. They go directly to the NTP, that's the network server, they change it. And why they change it? Just to like, it's not easy to trace. The log files are changed, so it's not easy to trace. So going back, use content, this one is done. Use encryption products to ensure data protection at rest, transit, and processing. Data at rest, use Bitdefender, BitLocker, anything, your C drive, your D drive, your drive should be protected. Use administrative passwords for that. That's your data at rest. Data in transit, that means we are talking about the data, which is the moving data from one point to the other. For example, I am accessing a web server. So that's the data in transit. So always use TLS, SSL certificates in your web server such that your website is protected. So Google also, when you search some websites, Google also give the preference on the top to the HTTP sites. It always give not a priority to the HTTP. HTTP is port 80, it never give port 80 a priority. It always give up, it always prioritize 443 traffic always. In processing, the data is in RAM. They have a software. I just saw that software. So, but it's still like there are question marks regarding software, that this software can be an issue. Deploy a data loss prevention system that enforce sharing Distribution policies should file their record across different transmission mechanism like file system, email messaging, and cloud. So you need to make sure that you're enforcing the policies in your environment using a policy like, for example, NAC. You can enforce policy using NAC, or you can use a simple Office 365 if you want to check. You can enforce the policy such that all your emails, your messaging, your file are safe. When sharing personal data, ensure appropriate de-identification mechanism are applied, such as tokenization or masking. So if you are making sure your data is protected, your document is protected, so you need to make sure that the masking is there, like X signs are there, tokenization is there, random values are added, salting, you can salt that data such that there's a different hash algorithm, there's a different hash for that file, such that nobody else can access that. So guys, any question, anyone in the classroom, guys, everyone? Anyone, speak to me, sleeping? No question, perfect. Anyone, anything, or everything is good? Just put yes, that everything is good. All good, thanks, thank you, Ibrahim. And thank you guys. You can now put your hands down. Thank you. You can put your hands down. I remember the classroom when I used to study in our university. Put your hands down, like you ask something, so it looks good. So like a review, I have just gone through the summary. So the review is, data is important. Sensitivity of the data is important. You must make sure that your data is always protected. And your data is, again, as I told you, data is very important in your real world. The fight is for the data only. Like if you just talk about the real, like the 4G world, where the data is for the cellular companies are fighting, the 5G. Why they all are fighting? Because 5G is a data war nowadays. Like how much you get the data is a good, you will work and your organization will grow. So like customer data, whenever you are working for any organization, so the customer data is important. Like, for example, if I get the customer data of Cisco Systems and I provide that data, that customer and customer data to Huawei, the Chinese company Huawei, so that will be a disaster. So that is the data importance of the data. You can just imagine how, if I get a data of any of the company, for example, if I have a customer data of banking environment, for example, Standard Chartered, I have a data and I give that data to Lloyds Bank. So that will be a disaster because the whole customer information is then gone. So that's like the important thing about the data. That's the importance of the data. So guys, daily benchmark. So I don't have the access, Derek or Franklin, guys, do you have the access for the benchmark, or you can just provide me, or I can share the screen, or that would be done after, like when Dwight joins. I'm not.
Let me send you the link right now if you have.
Please do send me the link. Okay, guys, you can just raise your hand. Like, you can put your hand down. I just stopped sharing your screen. I can see so many people. Okay, just put it down. Okay, I'm sorry. You can just raise it up as well. I was just thinking that you have putting your hand like this. Sorry, that's just the computer. I forgot. So, okay, just raise down. Like, when you are a child, like, you are raising the hand. Like, teacher, I want to ask a question. It was always like 10 or 20 people were doing this. So That's really nice.
I just shared the link with you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, sir. Okay, benchmark. Okay, today is day five.
Did you get it?
Yeah, I'm just checking. There are the reading materials. I cannot find the benchmarks.
All right. It's 2.4, right?
It's 3.5 today. Like
the 2.5. Okay. So the 2.5 is on the list. The list on the right. Do you see it?
Back to the tracks. Just a second. I will just go back to the track.
Do you see it?
Nope.
I can send you another link if you...
Yes, please. I'm getting lost somewhere.
Okay. 2.5. Just let me know if you open, if you can't open it. Let me see.
Yeah, please.
Do you have it?
I just received it. Let me open it. Yes. 2.5. Yes. Start quiz. Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, I have to go through all of these questions for 2.5.
No, so benchmark, you can let them go through it, and then we review it tomorrow. So okay. Benchmark for today. Mm-hmm. You let them go through it for the rest of the day or for the rest of the class, and then we review it 15 minutes before class tomorrow.
Yeah, I will just review it like quickly, like it will be easier for them.
Sure. Sure.
So we do have time. So I will not leave these guys so early, Franklin. No.
It's not about leaving
this is
them.
Not happening.
or that's why I gave you the one for yesterday, because normally you should review the one for yesterday today. But you were not in class yesterday, so.
Okay. That was just a joke. So guys, I will leave you alive. I know everyone is hungry. So let's go through this quickly. Benchmark, that is what use is made of TPM for NAC attestation. We have talked about NAC today and what NAC is, and there are different options that we have over here. So this is a long way that we have to go through. This is just like examination. Why are operating systems file access control not sufficient in the event of a loss, theft, and a computer mobile phone? So guys, like this is really just, yeah, frankly, you're right. This is really time consuming. So it will take time to do these questions. So what type of interoperability agreement would be appropriate for the outside of a two companies agreeing to work on another? So that would be the business factors. This one, these are the short one. I will just go through a bit, like guys over here. This is just for like, I will not reveal. Am I allowed to reveal the answer, Franklin? Or like this is just the test for them?
So normally benchmarks are for them to reflect on at the end of the day, at the end of the course of the lectures, so they can review the benchmark, practice the quiz, and then tomorrow you will just review it with them to make sure, so that they can go, hey, I did the right thing. That was the right answer for me, you know? Yeah. So today, we would have been going through 2.4. That's why I shared 2.4 with you, because 2.4 is the benchmarks for yesterday, if that makes sense.
Yes. Okay. That was yesterday, the daily homework. Okay, that's a homework. Okay. So Lloyd is not here. He's your instructor, so he normally checks this homework. Mm-hmm. So only Microsoft operating system application requires security patches. Like that's everyone. What is the hardening configuration? Hardening is a very important term, guys, just to make sure, like this is like a lot of answers are there. So hardening is in our real network. Normally we use the term hardening, like you need, there's something known as defense in depth. What is defense in depth? Defense in depth is just like important thing. Like you are creating a layer of security all the time. You're creating a layer of security. You say, okay, you just say that. This is a layer of security. Okay. Oops. Okay, that's a layer of security. You create a layer of security. That's a layer of security. How you create a layer of security? Like over here at the front, at the top, over here. This is your firewall. For example, this is your DMZ. First thing that anyone will enter in your organization would reach your external firewall. External firewall. This is the first thing, like if somebody's entering your network, they will enter using the first external firewall. Then they will go to, for example, they are dropping any email or they're just browsing. So they will go inside and they will find a proxy over here then. / load balancer, Abdullah, load balancer is here. So the load balancers are there. LB, load balancer. So load balancers are there always, and proxies are there to distribute the traffic. We have forward proxy, reverse proxy. We have load balancers like external firewall. Then they will check the proxy and LB. Then when they're getting inside the network, they do have internal firewall as well. They have internal firewall. Now we are talking about that they are going towards a private network. That's the most risky network. So before that, they will go to a DNS, like our host firewall, DNS firewall, because DNS server will host them towards. In the DNS server, we have something known as text records. We have MX records. If you have heard about MX records, you have different records. This will give a direction to the exchange server. So over here we have an exchange server, and the exchange server will forward that email. Over here we can also have email gateway. Email gateway. So guys, this is the process. Like over here you will have an external firewall, then you can go to the proxy. Over here proxy will help you to connect with the email gateway. If you have an email, it will directly connect to your internal firewall. We have a DNS and exchange server. Then the exchange server will forward the email to, for example, to Abdullah, and he will receive that email and he will fetch that email. This is known as, this whole process is known as defense in depth. There can be more important things, like it's like over here, it's not done. We can also create more defense to our host system as well. When the email is received by the host, that means by Abdullah's PC. So there is a host firewall enabled. That's your Windows firewall, for example. Firewall, that's your Windows firewall. Very commonly, 90% that's activated, like you just enable, like over here. This is your advanced firewall. It looks like this. That's your Windows firewall. You can just create your rules over here, inbound rules, new rule. If you want to block something, you say that, okay, port number, this, I will block like 110. That's the SQL port I will block. You allow the, if you say that, okay, I allow it, I can block it. So you can even allow it, you can just block it. Okay. So there are the firewalls. Thank you. 3.5 instance. Oh. Okay, I will just go through that. No worries. So host firewalls are there. So in between, like in the host, I'm talking about my laptop. I can have McAfee as well. Like right now, I have McAfee. That's basically connect safe. I do have, but that's the trial purpose. So if you see over here, this is the trial one, McAfee. No, I don't want to open it right now. So host, this is more defense in depth. You need to open your firewall, and McAfee is also there in my system. McAfee, sorry for the typos, fee, whatever. So McAfee is also there. Then I will open my Outlook. So you can just imagine how much. Now, the point over is that, like, how much you invest in your organization, that's the biggest challenge. Investment is more important, that the cost is most important factor in our IT world. Lot of companies are not investing a lot in IT. Like the chemical companies there, like I was doing consultations, there were my colleagues, they were giving consultation for the chemical organization. So they say, okay, we don't care about IT too much, like just reduce the cost. So the cost is important factor, like how much you put in, that much you get in. So that's the defense in depth. That was just a normal thing. I just want to close it. Okay, sorry guys, that there was some a little mistake over here. This is a 3.5 benchmark today. So we will start the quiz. You don't have to do the 2.5, that was 2.5. This is a 3.5. What is the difference between the role data steward and data custodian? Okay, that we have gone through. What set of information classification tags indicate degree of confidential, public, confidential, secret, critical, top secret, and other tagging schemes are proprietary, sensitive data? You can just put it down. PII is a personal information. Is there any data that could be used to identify, contact, locate individual? Yes, you are reviewing security, privacy, and okay. So over here, we can have multiple questions over here. Guys, everyone is alive.
I'm here.
Okay, perfect, perfect, perfect. Yes, yes, yes. Just put why. Yuppie, perfect, guys. So I'm not allowed to tell you all of the answers over here, but just a quick overview. Like what that's the question. So PII is again the personal information, that's for us only. And over here, let's go for a small question. To what data state does a trusted execution environment apply data protection? So trusted execution environment, that is a TEE, so that is normally used for our use one. So you take incident report for a user trying access report.docs file on a SharePoint site, so you can replace it with the quarantine. This one is good, like you need to spend some time over here, guys. Compte security plus labels, okay, you have completed a note under this heading. You should data minimization, okay, this is a good one. Which of the answer are listed below refers to the solution allowing administrator to block internal access for users until they perform their required action? So you can quarantine the network. You have different options. Captive portal is for the guest users. Firewall, like you can block the traffic using firewall. Honeypot is for the testing purpose, or it is known as a decoy. WPS is a Wi-Fi protected setup. 90% that's already been enabled in your network. So that's a push button basically, and you don't need to disable it. That's not a good practice, but you can disable it for some functionality, but by default in a TP-Link they are enabled. Where are the characteristics feature of WPA, WPA2 enterprises modes? We have two modes in our WPA and WPA2. We have one mode is known as WPA personal. That's like normal home office and small office, home office, SOHO.